imagine getting a letter in the mail. You're married to a woman who's from Kenya, and peaceful people, right? And all of a sudden the state says you have 30 days and you have $1,500 to come up with, and if you didn't, we'll deport your wife. How would you feel? You'd be pretty terrified if you didn't have $1,500. You know, in America, there are a lot of families who are paycheck to paycheck, right? The state aggression, as a libertarian, we should see that clearly as day, how much it harms you. But that's just not it. I mean, there are many stories, like the one of myself. When I had to go through this process, the process of this vetting, what we're calling, it is so intense. And this is a little bit of a different vetting, because the requirements to qualify to become a resident, green card holder, in other words, it's insane. You have to find someone who can sponsor you, right? And say you're a complete stranger like I was. I was a complete stranger in this country. Here, you know, as a student going through college, and I wanted to become a resident, wanted to live here. Love this country so much. And I needed to find someone who made a certain amount of dollar based on their family, right? Like, if some, back then, this is like 2001 or two, back then, if you were just a single person, weren't married, you probably at least had to make like $30,000 or $40,000 to be able to sponsor another person. Right? And that sponsor means you have to disclose your tax documents, social security number, all that to a complete stranger like me, right? That who is going to be submitting that to INS, right? At the time it was called INS. And then go through the approval process and interviews and all those things. Now imagine the horror. Who do I go to and say, hey, can I have your social security number, please? Ernie, will you give me your social security number? I don't think so, right?
What country are you from?
I am actually an immigrant from Pakistan. So you have to, and that's just not it. You have to go through fingerprints. You have to go through background checks. You have to go through, back then it was also, they used to do blood tests, right? Like they would want to make sure you don't have like AIDS or, you know, similar diseases that are, like even hepatitis, right? You had, I think C is the worst kind, I could be wrong. But if you had hepatitis, you would not be, yes, visa okay, right? And as a matter of fact, even before you got the visa, like I got the visa, I had to go through a medical test. But a lot of times, like in, you know, third world countries, you can fake that. You can bribe the doctor and say, all right, make me a thing that says I don't have hepatitis. That does happen, though, trust me. My best friend is a surgeon, right? I don't have any of those, by the way. But, so you have to go through that and, you know, pay fees. When I applied for residency, that was not just one form. There were a few of them. The very first one I had to do is to apply for a social security number. But they wouldn't give me a social security number unless I have a reply from INS that says, yes, we received his information. He is now in the process of becoming a resident. Whether they do it or not, that's a different story, but yes, give him a social security number. So I got my social security number. Then, the next process is, which costs $200 to apply for a work permit. I'm still not allowed to work in this country, make a living, in other words. I need someone's permission to tell me that I can breathe and live and eat, or not. So I have to fill that form up. Send that back to INS, wait for a few months. They'll send me a really nice letter saying, yes, you're approved. And then, by the way, on the social security card, I actually still have that original social security card. It says, allowed to work only by the authorization of INS. That's what it says. If anybody wants to see it later on, it's in my pocket. But it literally says that. So if I go to somebody looking for work, right? I go to anybody and say, hey, I need some work. I'll work for whatever company you give me. They'll look at my social security card and they'll say, where's your work permit? And then be like, I actually don't have one. Now you can't get a job, right? Because it's, I'm pretty sure that it's a criminal offense to hire someone without that permission, right? So you go through that process, and then there are these extensive interviews about, okay, who are you, where are you from, all those things, right? And based on your type of visa, if it's marriage visa, you take your woman in the other room, you take, okay, understood. There's a lot, they used to be, these are, I hear stories. At least I saw one movie in which it was like a, you know, a deal. A guy was paying a woman to, I think it's called Green Card, it's a really nice movie. Towards the end, they fell in love, but they deported him anyways. But so to prevent that, right, they separate you in separate rooms, and they have questions. The most personal questions, the most privacy-invasive questions you can imagine. What side of the bed you sleep on? What's the, even like questions like, what is the size of your bra? Can you imagine being asked, what is people's dignity? You understand me? We're talking bedding, right? What is this? This is insult, is what I call it. But anyway, I had to go through that, and then they give you this temporary card that says temporary on it, right? So the employer now was going to hire you, is going to set a calendar date and say, all right, I better make sure that it doesn't go day over at work unless I provide it. Another citizenship card that says permanent. The green card is called permanent residence, right? But they don't, the card itself does not, never say green card. It's like U.S. permanent resident, what it says. And it's not green. It has some green ink on it. That I'll give them that. And you have to go through so many hoops, right, to become a resident here. Now imagine you become a resident, right? And you plan on, and I know some people who today, right? Not from the countries that are banned, but from other countries who have decided to stay here just as, on the green card, as a permanent resident, and do not want to become citizens. As a matter of fact, some of them, there are a few people who cannot become U.S. citizen because they don't know English. If you can't pass that the quiz or the test that they give you, right, you cannot become a U.S. citizen. It's not a very hard test. It's 99 questions. When you file for citizenship exam, they give you this whole, okay, there's a little booklet, learn about our constitution, learn about our whatever, right? And if you fail the test, we're sending you back, or you just pick stay resident. So people don't even go. It's like, I don't know English. I'm not going to be able to do this, right? But long story short, you see that, you know, how difficult the entire vetting process is, and with today's Trump's ban, what it does to people, there are a lot of people who have lives here. They bought homes, they bought, you know, their children are going to schools, all that stuff. And all of a sudden, if they're traveling, and all of a sudden they're trying to come back in, you stop them at the airport. Their families are here. Half the families here, half of them, they're stopped at the airport. Or they're not even allowed to get on board on the plane from a certain country, right? That's terrorism, if you ask me, because you're breaking families. What if that person is responsible for feeding two children and a woman who might not work, just a housewife or something? Can you imagine what kind of pain and suffering that family has to go through now? Just because someone wrote on a piece of paper that cannot enter this country anymore. A long time ago, I want to say in mid-2000s, there was a whistleblower on the United States government. His name was J. Michael Springman. And I met him personally, and I've heard some of the stories he's told about the whole visa process, right? As I was saying earlier, that getting the visa is so hard to begin with. I could be wrong on the statistics, but someone had said that only 1% of the visa, visa applicants, only 1% of the applicants actually get the visa. And there are different types of visas, student visa, work visa, blah, 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 right? Visit visa and, you know, family visas, and then of course immigration visas. So you have to have an interview at the U.S. embassies across the world, wherever you're applying from, to pass that vetting process there. And what's involved? They go through your security background, they check your bank accounts, they want to see your domiciles, your property, all that stuff. Want to know everything about your brothers and sisters too, right? They do this extreme background check. At least they do it in my ex country, Pakistan. They go through every process. As a matter of fact, the National ID Card Act that has been passed, in most of these countries, third world countries, based on United Nations mandates and American pressures, those countries already have them. Pakistan has a National ID Card. That is shared with the United States and the rest of the world. So if you're trying to come from Pakistan and you're a known terrorist, you should not be getting a visa. And that's what J. Michael Springman was saying. He was saying that I, personally, when I was in Saudi Arabia, and this is before 9/11, have rejected anybody who was on that list, who is a known terrorist, right? So we're hurting people based on the negligence of the immigration agents that are sitting over there, right? Yeah, I agree, no terrorist should be allowed in any other country than their own. It shouldn't be right where they are, right? They shouldn't exist, actually. Terrorists shouldn't exist, but... So that's the process. What's with this? We give you the visa, and then we'll test you again, and then we'll make you resident, and then we'll ban you from coming in. That's not, 600,000. There are 600,000 Muslims in New York City alone. 600,000 said, and I'm going to give you another really interesting statistics in a minute. But if we were all so violent and we were such a big threat, New York City would have been a mess right now. You understand? They're all peace-loving people. All they want to do is get up in the morning, just like the rest of us, right? Go to work, go to school, whatever it is that we do, and come back home and feed our families. But no, we can't have that. You see, immigration is such a hot topic in this country right now. Here's another funny statistic for you. 51% of the American PhDs are all foreign-born. 51% is a fact for you. Some of them could be banned, right? From their families, from their lives here. The trouble is the state, again, strikes, right? They use the threat of, Islamophobia. It's rampant. They use the propaganda and they create this fear among American people, right? Or whatever it is, their new boogeyman, right? Right now it's all Muslims, right? Except certain countries. And based on that fear, right, it's all the Sharia. Sharia is coming to take over you. Or the jihadists are here and they're doing the soft jihad here. Whatever that means, right? But here's a crazier fact from the last two facts I just pointed out. American population, Muslim population, is less than 1% of this country's population. Do you think anyone out there that less than 1%, and it's been that figure for a long time, and it's not really changing much, fraction. If anybody thinks that less than 1% can impose Sharia law on American public, I don't know what fairy tales you live in. I just don't know the answer. The trouble is with the misconceptions about Sharia. If you don't know what Sharia law is, then talk to a Muslim and ask them what Sharia law is. Sharia law to us literally means that our ability to pray 5 times a day, to fast when we want to feed our neighbor when we want to, not kill anybody, not harm anybody, don't steal. Our commandments are Sharia. That's it. That's all there is to it. Nothing more, nothing less. You see? I mean, I can go on and on and tell you, I don't know how many stories of, yes.
I'm interested in your personal experiences. Do you think this is a media thing, political thing, it's made up on TV thing, or are you experiencing problems yourself?
No, not personally. I'm a U.S. citizen now. I've been a citizen since 2000.
No, I mean the cultural, the way you're seeing it, you know, you're Muslim, you know, is that a problem? I mean, if you really take the Muslim community, is it mostly from TV that they're being portrayed, or their neighbors starting to? We have a story today, a burned a mosque in Texas, and a local synagogue gave them the keys to their synagogue.
That's right. I heard about that.
So I'm wondering, is it made up or is it real, the, you know,
right,
the persecution?
I think it's, right now it's in a smaller scale. I don't think it's affected every American Muslim yet. But just as much as the Americans are afraid of the Sharia and the terrorism and whatever, Muslims are now afraid of their fellow Americans. I'm just going to share a personal story. I have a customized plate in the city of Hampshire. I won't say here what it is, because I'm trying to get rid of it. But it's controversial. And my wife had been in tears after I had returned from Iraq, because I went to pilgrimage there in November, and it came back. And, you know, current circumstances, she could not stop crying because she felt that that license plate on my car was a threat to me. That would give anybody a reason to just kill me because of the color of my skin and what they misunderstand it for. So there is fear. There is a lot of fear. I used to open carry because I'm a libertarian. I believe in the right to protect, right? To protect yourself, your family, your property. I don't do that anymore. You know what I'm afraid of? Some crazy guy would just shoot me and say I killed a terrorist. He was going to kill somebody. Who's going to defend me? You see, I'm not here to collect sympathies. I'm just saying, you know, that's the kind of fear that we even have in this country, dealing with a lot of stuff. It's easy, you know, when you have support. It's very difficult when you don't. When the entire, you know, and on social media you can see how much hatred there is against, you know, our community, Muslims in particular. Does that answer your question?
How does this compare to post 9/11? A lot of them had, there was this, I don't know how long it lasted, but you definitely, the people I knew in the Muslim or from the Middle East, there was definitely a reaction. They changed their behavior. Are you seeing something similar to that or different now?
You mean in the Americans?
The Americans.
Yeah. I think it's hard to say. I mean, this Trump phenomenon is so strange even to us libertarians. It kind of feels the same way. I was in it, you know, 2001, when this whole thing happened. I was in my first year of college, first semester of college, actually. I'd come to the States a month before, exactly 30 days. And that happened, and the stuff that I, you know, some of us had to go through, the FBI raids, and you cannot leave the city, and taking our passports and, you know, collecting them into their FBI offices, and things like that. And our, you know, professors or dean at the college telling us, we can't protect you, protect yourself, and you know, life threats, all those things. So we have seen that firsthand. I've seen it. You know, I've seen a pickup truck pull up to me and, you know, say things to me and say, leave or we will kill you, kind of thing. So I haven't personally seen anything like that ever since. But it seems like if you, at least if you pay attention to the media, the, you know, whatever media you follow, if you follow the comment section, you'll see that there is a lot of hatred. There is a lot of support as well. I just want to point out that there is a lot of support. But the battle is, you know, it's an uphill battle for us. It's a matter of life and death to the immigrants. We're already here. You know.
Do you mind if I, my family's from Iran, do you mind if I just answer his question from my own perspective?
Absolutely, go ahead.
I don't know if anyone in this room saw, but there was a post on Lawfare blog by a guy named Ben Wittes at the Brookings Institute. He's someone who's very pro-law enforcement, very hawkish. He had defended waterboarding, military commissions, mass surveillance, et cetera, et cetera. he had kind of the most, I thought, phenomenal reaction to the travel ban. And what he said is, all of the things that happened after 9/11, all the things that he was personally involved with and defended, even if they had costs on particular groups, he had a sincere belief that he was doing it for the sake of the safety of the country. What he said about the travel ban is that if you look at what happened, it was clearly, in this man's view, this is a guy who's very pro-law enforcement, and he said it was clearly an act of malice and not done for even a kind of speculative common good. And the exact example he used was that initially the DHS had told, had gone, and this has been reported by multiple outlets, the DHS had gone up to the White House and said, we need to make sure green card holders, temporary visa holders, these people who've already been vetted through all the extreme processes he talked about, are not covered by this ban the way people in like refugee camps are. And they had a directive from Steve Bannon and Stephen Miller, the people who are writing these articles about 10 Things I Hate About Islam on Breitbart, that you absolutely have to include these green card holders too. And this is an act of malice that I, as an Iranian who was around in 2011 versus 2017, I think this is a whole different, I don't think it's even, I'm actually kind of different from yours. I think this is something I'm shocked to the core.
Trump's latest action.
And I went to Dulles Airport, I'm an attorney, and I went to Dulles Airport to volunteer translation services for immigration attorneys there. And you just walk around and you see a sea of people from these countries in tears because their relatives are stranded in God knows where, in whatever country. It is, in my perspective, this is completely unlike 9/11.
No, I just meant the reaction of the community, not that was...
Well, my personal reaction as a member of kind of the Iranian American community is that this is much scarier stuff than anything George Bush, 9/11, anything like that. So
I want to add, there was a similar law that was at least talked about or passed by Obama administration that talked about the same 7 countries ban, right? The only difference between, and I'm not taking Obama's administration side at all by any means, because the attorneys don't do that, right? the difference was that the ban was on refugees, but the refugees were still back there, right? Like they're not here yet. So vetting there, a single dude who was pretty healthy and whatever, right? And versus a family, I can see the debate. Like, why are we bringing this person who can probably move somewhere closer over there, and versus the children? The difference now is that all those people who are already here, we're breaking their families, right? We're breaking the families apart. We're terrorizing them. You understand? People are invested with their lives. And think about that for a second. Money, right? Wealth, property, emotions, right? People have families here, right? Separating people's parents from their children. That is terrorism, I think. I don't know if you guys agree with me or not, but that's how I feel about that. And it is very, very, like 9/11, even the Muslim community was right along with the Americans. Yes, this is ridiculous. Whoever brought these buildings down should be held accountable, right? All the 19 hand hijackers, we were all with USA. We were all wearing the same flag, right? Back then I wasn't actually here. I was pretty status back then. I wore a lot of flags. I still do sometimes. The Muslim community here was already here, whether they were on a visa or they were citizens or residents. They were all behind the United States. No, we're against terrorism, right? And this is what Muslims for Liberty stand for. We are also against terrorism, right? Muslims are against terrorism. We don't believe in terrorism. We don't belong in any organization that promotes hatred and violence. That's just it, right? So, yes, I 100% agree with them. 100% agree with them.
Decades ago, in World War II times, they called Germans Krauts and Japanese Japs. And I don't know what the pejorative is for Muslims now, but every country...
Turbanheads?
Well, I don't know.
Yeah.
But every country we're at war with, in my point, becomes country culture becomes demonized. And so I'm looking at the only website I could find the right title of an article was The Intercept. Trump's Muslim Immigration Executive Order, if we bombed you, we banned you. So why I find this really interesting is the elephant in the room is, why is Saudi Arabia not on the list?
Because it wasn't on Obama's list.
Haven't bombed them yet.
But it shows it has nothing really to do with either 9/11 or terrorism or anything. It's the current wars that a lot of Americans don't even know that we're in. Libya is on the list. What else is on it?
All your countries now an IMF bank.
That too, yeah.
Right. A lot of people don't know, but we're helping Saudi Arabia bomb in Yemen.
Yes.
And so, like, I don't know. Like, why is that not pointed out even in your advocacy? I think that would be the main point, which is
we do.
It's just demonizing the people you're at war with. Oh, by the way, did you know you're at war with a lot of Muslim countries? Still, did you know?
Right.
Because Americans don't even know.
That's right. I was, just not to interrupt you, but a small, short story. There's a mercenary who's in Iraq, and he's posted a video that's gone viral. And the video is, he allegedly talked to some Iraqi. By the way, I've been to Iraq. I even was robbed there, let's just put it that way. I've seen some wreckage of Iraq. But the nicest people in the world, if I've ever met, Iraqi people. I'm not from Iraq. Okay, free food, free shelter, you name it. Okay, I was there for the single largest protest, anti-war protest that happens every year, twice a year. Okay, 26, 27 million people go there one day to make this protest. Just look that up sometimes. I was there. I've actually just finished up writing a small ebook, so if anybody's interested, I can share that with you guys. Just get my email afterwards. But
what's the date called?
So one of them is called Ashura, and the other one is called Arba'in, and I was there for Arba'in.
What does that mean?
So Arba'in, literal meanings are 40, I think. 40 or 40th in Arabic. I'm not an expert in Arabic by any means. I don't know Arabic much, but it's a commemoration of an event that occurred roughly 1,400 years ago that had killed the family of the Prophet. And people who killed the family of the Prophet, I'm talking about his son and his granddaughters, you know, grandchildren, was carried out by the ISIS-likes of the time, the state of the time, right? So ever since then, Shias, Sunnis, Christians, Jews, Hindus alike are going there to Arba'in in the city of Karbala to protest this anti-war, anti-violence protest. And the numbers have grown significantly in the last few years because in Saddam's regime, he didn't allow that. You know, Saddam Hussein's never, if he found out that people were gathering for whatever reason, he'd break that, he'd take you to prison. So you couldn't congregate, you couldn't, you know, do anything like that. And now after Saddam Hussein and the new government and security scenarios, every year is growing, every year, you know, it's a few years ago it was 10 million, last year was roughly 20, this year it was 27, some even say 33 million, but I think that one's a little sketchy number, but it doesn't matter, numbers don't matter, Muslims are out there protesting violence, okay, Muslims for Liberty, libertarian Muslims all across the country, all across the world.